Hey, motherfuckers.
Fuck this shit, I'm out. Fuck this shit, I'm out.
No thanks.
Don't mind me. I'ma just grab my stuff and leave. Excuse me, please. Fuck this shit, I'm out.
Nope.
Fuck this shit, I'm out.
All right, then.
I don't know what the fuck just happened, but I don't really care. I'ma get the fuck up out of here.
Fuck this shit, I'm out.
Yo, what's up, motherfuckers? It's the one and only Fubar motherfucking guru. Yo, played it up. I'm a hat on. And guess what? I just finished that. Yeah, that's my fucking shit that I just fucking carved and stained and gave to my buddy. And, Paulo, get your hands off your mama's painting. And, I just painted this. And, I hope you guys like it. It's pretty fucking cool. So, just to give you a little FYI, we got a lot of stuff to talk about tonight, y'all. So, I'm gonna play some Counter-Strike. The wife and I are gonna listen to an audiobook. And then we got a lot of stuff to share about what's going on in the world. And, hey, guess what? YESHUA's coming back. Soon, too. So I hope you guys enjoyed tonight. And just so you know, I'm down to two platforms. I can only stream to Omelette and YouTube because I got a 24-hour ban on Facebook. And I got a 30-day ban on Twitch, but I ain't going to use it no more because they side with fucking Muslims who want to fucking kill me. So, you know what? Fuck you, Twitch. I do not care. You're pay to play anyway. So let's play some fucking Counter-Strike, shall we? Yeah. You can start the book again if you want. Or we can listen to music, whatever you want to do. Oh, what do I want to do? What is casual? Deathmatch war game? Okay, give it a shot. Fuck it. Oh, I hit the wrong button. Or whatever. Okay. Match is ready. Let's roll, yo. Let's have a good game. Smoke it if you got it. Did that chick respond to you from doing that video? Or, like,
Alright,
you didn't do it, I forgot.
Cover this area. Alright.
Let's go. Alright, team, let's have a good game. Just kinda like search and destroy. Listen to music. Do you want me to start something else?
Go, go, go! At our entry point.
I agree.
My father.
Your father?
He lifted his stairs to the gates behind me, and a growl rumbled through me as he went to sleep.
Ah, shit, don't work. Damn it. My fucking shit. Does my shit not work?
I saw the rocket falling down, sucking in a breath to tell my father to run, but he wasn't there.
Yeah, okay. And see, access negative. Where the fuck is that?
Remain propped up against the tree. Mountain ash. They hadn't been there moments before.
Let's do this quick.
As if they were nothing but water. And then the bow and quiver became a large pot laden with clouds. Another ripple, and there were my sisters, huddled together weeping.
I do not care.
What is? I didn't
care. I found my shit.
The house was definitely a flawless vessel.
What?
I'm beyond me and let out a smile so vicious that whatever the thing was by the gate shimmered with light and darted out as fast as lightning sweeping through the air.
No. Window, top shelf.
If you're ever going to run away, at least you're in a good time. He stared me down, and the fire slowly retracted. There are worse than the fog prowling these woods at night.
Somehow
my mouth began working again. And of all the things to say, I blurted.
Nice play.
Can you blame me? My crippled father appears beneath my window and you think I'm not going to run for him? Do you actually think I'd gladly stay here forever? Even if you're taking care of my family, all for some reason that has nothing to do with me and allows your kind of smart humans to drink his dick?
Behind the wall, on your sis.
He flexed his fingers, as if trying to get the claws back in, but they remained out, ready to slice through flesh and bone. What do you want, Sarah? I want to go home!
Come on!
You prefer that miserable human existence to this? I made a promise. I agreed in love.
Fuck!
To my mother when she died. That I'd look after my family, that I'd take
care of my family.
Every single day, every hour has been for that vow. And just because I was hunting to save my family, to put food in their bellies, I'm now forced to break it. He stopped toward the house. And I gave him a wide berth before following his step behind him. His claws slowly attacked him. He didn't look at me enough.
Fuck this shit, I'm out. Fuck this shit, I'm out. Mountains, don't mind me. I'ma just grab my stuff and leave. Excuse me, please. Fuck this shit, I'm out. Nope. Fuck this shit, I'm out. Alright then, I don't know what the fuck just happened, but I don't really care. I'ma get the fuck up out of here. This shit, I'm out.
That's what all those years I've given them would be. As insignificant as I was to be had. But that dream I had of one day living with my father with enough food and money.
Take me by the hand, and get you on. That you understand. You should not walk the streets of a
prison. Even if I had been a fool, a stupid human fool, to believe my father would ever actually come for me. Cameron and I didn't fight long. You're not giving up on them. Living in luxury? Stuffing myself with food? How's that not? They all cared. Dead and comfortable. Dead and comfortable. If you couldn't lie, if it was true, then anything I'd ever dared hope for. Then, my vow to my mother was
Good shot.
I tried not to think about it, but still I asked, were you trained as a warrior then?
Let's move out.
Yes.
Move it up. Here we go, team. We got this.
When I didn't reply, you asked.
On the left hand side.
I spent most of my life as a warrior, training as a warrior to one day serve him, or others. Running these lands is not supposed to fall from me. The flatness with which he said it told me enough about how he felt about his current title, about why the presence of his silver-tongued friend was necessary. What many of them saw the wood beyond this gate, if the god is the worst of them? What was that thing? What I meant to ask was, what would have tormented and then eaten me? Who are you to be so powerful that they chose to talk to you?
Oh well, don't care.
He paused on the bottom of the box, waiting for me to pop up. A puka. Then they eat you. Slowly. It probably smells your human scent in the woods that followed it to the house. I shivered and didn't bother to hide it. Cameron went on. These lands used to be well guarded. The deadlier berries were contained within the borders of their native territories.
Counter-terrorist
win. Or driven into hiding. Creatures like the Puka never would have dared step foot here. But now, the sickness that infected Prithian has weakened the wards that kept them out.
This is it, let's go!
A long time, but the words were choked out of him. Things are different now. It's not safe to travel alone. Humans were senseless as babies compared to natural born predators like Easton and Cameron, who didn't need weapons to hunt. I glanced at his hands, but found no place for claws, and his tanned, callous skin. What else did you think of?
Nice shot.
Turning up the marble front steps. He didn't stop this time. He even looked over his shoulder a few minutes, as he said. Everything. So I truly was there forever. As much as I longed to ensure that Cameron's word about
Total Carnage!
As much as his claim that I was taking better care of my family by staying away, even if I was truly fulfilling that vow to my mother by staying in prison, without the weight of that promise, I was left hollow and empty. Over the next 3 days, I found myself joining Lucian and Andrew's old patrol while Cameron hunted around for the boss on team battle. Despite being an occasional bastard, Lucian didn't seem to mind my company, and he did most of the talking, which was fine. It left me to brood over the consequences of firing a single arrow. An arrow. I never fired a single one during those 3 days we rode around the border. That very morning I spied a red doe in a glen and aimed out of instinct. My arrow poised to fly right into her eye as Lucian sneered that she was out there with me. But I stared at her, fat and healthy and content. And then flapping the bow, replaced the arrow in my quiver and let the doe wander on. I never saw Cameron around the manor. Back up to the bar, day and night, he was the best. Even a minute, he took minutes before he was gone. He was off to continue his hunt, night after night. I didn't mind his absence. It was a relief, if I could say.
Alright, don't run to your death now!
On the third night after my encounter,
but I like running towards the bullets.
I scarcely sat down before Cameron got up. She gave an excuse about not wanting to waste hunting time. Lucian and I stared after him for a moment. What I could see of Lucian's face was pale and tight. Do you worry about him? I said. Lucian slumped in his seat, wholly undignified for a fey lord. Cameron gets into moods. He doesn't want your help hunting the bar? He preferred being alone, but having the bog on our land, I don't suppose he'll understand. The Puka are minor enough not to bother him, but even after he discovered the bog, he screwed over it. And there's no one who can help him at all? He would probably shred them for disobeying his order to stay away.
Let's get this started.
Well, I don't fucking
A brush of ice slithered across my neck. He would be that brutal. Ethan studied the wine in his goblet. You don't hold on to power by being a And among the fairies, Lester and Hasbro alike, a firm hand is needed.
Also, I don't even know what long haul is, man. Like, I gotta figure that out.
Like, I'm really not trying to be a dick, but the best way I can describe it is the long haul.
That sounds, I really thought that. I thought the same thing. It was like, that probably makes sense. Let me see, am I there now? No, I'm at side haul. Hey, which one's longer than side haul?
Well, the call out's long haul, but it's like actually called side haul. I don't know. Maybe it's just what I call it.
I understand. I understand. Oh, no, I know you're there. You're coming to me. I'm not going over there. Oh, fuck. Who's getting me? Oh, somebody saved my ass, right?
As I walked down the dark halls of the manor, the servants and Lucian ran to the street. But I had to do something, anything after that went there. A bit of paper in one hand and a pen gripped in the other.
Oh, man, I missed. Stop it. Wait, is that the one I wanted? Wait, who did I get? Nah, that's not the one I wanted. I'll take it, though.
Babe, you're asking me to look at it. Like, what?
Hey, good game, y'all.
Good game. I didn't dare risk a candle. These past 3 days, there had been servants in the halls when I had worked up the nerve to look at the art. and the part of me that spoke with Nestor's voice had laughed at the idea of an ignorant human trying to admire fairy art. Some other time then, I told myself. I would find another day, a quiet hour when no one was around to look at them. I had plenty of hours now, a whole lifetime in front of me. Perhaps I'd figure out what I wished to do with it. I crept down the main staircase, moonlight flooding the black and white tiles of the entrance hall. I reached the bottom, my bare feet silent on the cold tiles, and listened. Nothing. No one. I set my little map on the foyer table and drew a few X's and circles to signify the doors, the windows, the long upstairs of the front hall. I've become so familiar with the house that I've navigated even if someone blinded me. A breeze announced his arrival, and I turned from the table toward the long hall and the open glass doors to the garden. I've forgotten how pleased he was in this place.
Oh shit, bro! Yo, he zoosed me! Oh shit!
Sorry, man.
My god, dude. Alright, you got my respect, bro. I ain't fucking with you anymore. That was fucking epic.
That was fear, Zeus.
And in the moonlight, a shining thing were left in his wake. He continued toward me,
Oh man. Jesus Christ, not only did I get out Zeus,
Lord, you saved me.
A puff of uneven breathing because of her breath.
I got out off, and then I got Zeus for good measure, bro. Monster, man.
When at last my eyes adjusted to the returning darkness, he was standing in front of me. Standing, but not quite there. No sign of the baldric or his knives.
Am I supposed to make fun of people for using autos? Is that the protocol?
He looked at it blankly, as if it took some monumental effort to remember that he even had a hand, and that it was useless.
Let me juice up, don't kill me, don't kill me!
And strength had it taken to kill the dog, to save that wretched mother. How deep had he had to dig inside himself, to whatever immortal power and animal that lived there, to kill it? He glanced down at the map on the table, and his voice was void of anything. Any emotion, any
anger,
or amusement, as he said. What is that? I snatched up the map. I thought I could blame my surroundings. Drip. Drip. Drip.
Russia.
I opened my mouth to point out his hand again, but he said, you can't run, can you? I didn't answer. I didn't know what to say.
That's
it's an insignificant human.
Oh man, I'm trying to get close. It's not gonna happen. I'm gonna engage on a mission
of vengeance. Dude, leave me alone.
I'm gonna keep trying to get vengeance and just die. Basically die the whole time.
I wanted to tell myself that it was probably the most useful thing I've learned all night. And as I followed him there, avoiding the blood he carried, I thought that he was going to be on
his isolation. Shit! Who got me? Was that you, man?
Yeah.
Nice shot.
I meant to Zeus you.
I think just as brutal, bro.
The infirmary was well staffed, but was more of a supply closet with a work table than an actual place to host sick sailors.
Nice
I suppose
shot.
That was all they needed when they could feel themselves with their immortal power. But this wound wasn't healing.
Shit, now I gotta super watch my back. I told you too much shit, now I gotta watch my back.
When I gathered what I needed, I tried not to balk at the thought of touching him, but I didn't let myself give in to my dread if I took his hand. The heat of his skin like an inferno against my cool fingers. I cleaned off his bloody, dirty hands.
Ah, I was Bot Victor. Whack. Wasn't even a human, bro. Dude, I can't really understand your mic, man. I don't want to be douchey, I just have a hard time understanding you.
No, I'm Diendo.
Sorry about that, I'll fix it.
And the room became too small. He killed the dog and walked away relatively unscathed. If Tamlin was that powerful, then the High Lords of Prithian must be near God. Every mortal instinct in my body bleated in panic at the thought. I was almost at the open door, battling the urge to bolt back to my room.
Damn, all you hear is coughs. Boom, boom.
Right.
Yet you learn
to
help. Oh shit.
How? Paused with my foot on the threshold. That's what happens when you're responsible for lives other than your own, isn't it? You do what you have to do. He was still sitting on the table, still straddling the inner line between the here and now and wherever he had to go in his mind to endure the fight with the dog.
My walking slow button, I keep hitting it by mistake. I got it like on the scroll wheel. Which I also used to get to my Zeus. I keep hitting it. I don't have to change that bind.
The next morning, as I made my way down the grand staircase, I tried not to think too much about the clean washed marble tiles on the floor below. No sign of the blood Tamlin had lost. I tried not to think too much at all about our encounter, actually.
Nice shot.
When I found the front hall empty, I almost smiled. Felt a ripple in that hollow emptiness that had been hounding me. Perhaps now, perhaps in this moment of quiet...
Jesus, it's nasty out there.
Take time to observe it, learn it.
I can't reach! I didn't reach!
I was about to head toward a hall I had noted was nearly covered in painting after painting, when low male voices floated out from the dining room. I paused. The voices were tense enough that I made my steps silent as I slid into the shadows behind the open door. A cowardly, wretched thing to do. But what they were saying had me shoving aside any guilt. I just want to know what you think you're doing. It was Lucian, that familiar, lazy viciousness coating each word. What are you doing? Cameron snapped. Through the space between the hinge and the door, I could glimpse the two of them standing almost face to face. On Cameron's non-bandaged hands, his claws shone in the morning light. Me? Lucian put a hand on his chest. By the cauldron, Cam, there isn't much time, and you're just sulking and glowering. You're not even trying to fake it anymore. My brows rose. Cameron turned away, but foiled back a moment later, his teeth bared. It was a mistake from the start. I can't stomach it, not after what my father did to their kind, to their land. I won't follow in his footsteps, won't be that sort of person, so back off. Back off? Back off while you steal our faith and ruin everything? I stayed with you out of hope, not to watch you stumble. For someone with a heart of stone, yours is certainly soft these days. The bog was on our land. The bog, Camlin! The barriers between courts have vanished, and even our woods are teeming with filth like the puka. Are you just going to start living out there? Slaughtering every bit of vermin that slinks in? Watch your mouth, Camlin said. Lucian stepped toward him, exposing his teeth as well. A pulsing kind of air hit me in the stomach, and a metallic stench filled my nose. But I couldn't see any magic, only feel it. I couldn't tell if that made it worse. Don't push me, Lucian. Cameron's tone became dangerously quiet, and the hair on the back of my neck stood as he emitted a growl that was pure animal. You don't think I know what's happening on my own land? What I've got to lose? What's lost already? The blight. Perhaps it was contained, but it seemed it was still wreaking havoc, still a threat, and perhaps one they didn't truly want me knowing about, either from lack of trust or because I...
I'll be
lying
common after sliding with Jupiter.
Nice.
Now also...
Okay.
Chinese New Year, Year of the Ox, Year of the Beast.
Yep. Which is why I brought it up, because I mean, isn't that significant that they're talking about
the Red Dragon? The woman comes riding on the back of the Red Dragon.
Red Dragon.
Which is Planet X.
Which is Planet X. Okay. This is interesting. I like how it all tying in together. And it's Chinese. 200 million man army. Oh, that's not a coincidence. Play some Rocket League. I love this shit. I'm not half bad at it, to be quite honest with you. Oh, my controller's getting stupid, so I'm still getting used to playing CSGO with a fucking controller. With the PC, because, I'm telling you, heats doubles? Oh, I want to play that. I like Heatseeker, it's fun. Kind of like Pong. And to, the guys who create Rocket League, you guys need to make a Transformer fucking mode. Like Twisted Metal, where like you just go all out and have weapons and shit and just fucking blast each other with smithereens with missiles and fucking rockets and shit. Oh, I missed. My bad. Oh, just rocket. Should we put some music on or something?
Yeah.
You okay? Tell me when you want to go out, man. You cool? What do you want to do? What's up, man? You wanna listen to something? Or... I said I'd listen to anything, man. Is it music or a book? I just don't know. I just shut off and I don't know what you're doing. Yeah, and I was done.
You mean the family is talking up the opportunity to mock an ignorant mortal? You
fuck
the book.
Fuck, guys. You suck. Love you. You suck.
Why should I mock you for a shortcoming that it is your fault? Let me help you. I owe you for the hand. Shortcoming. But why is it shortcoming? Yes, it was one thing to bandage the past. To talk to him as if he wasn't the predator built to kill and destroy. But to reveal how little I truly knew. To let him see that part of me that was full of power. Unfinished and raw? His face was unreadable. There would have been no pity in his voice, well, I told you. And then... Do you think I've got nothing better to do with my time than come up with a lack of ways to humiliate you? I thought of that fear of nothing but the danger of me surrendering to the human land and didn't have an answer. At least, not one that was polite. I've given enough already to them. The prince. I'm ready to his head. When you let you think that you are time, you can. I will correct you quietly, but not softly. Doesn't pretend to be anything but what you is. Yes, that's the quote for you. He cried. And his claws played the factor, even as he clenched his hands and the fist at his side. I was definitely walking a dangerous line, but I didn't care. Even if it offered me sanctuary, I didn't have to fall into the sea. With me, I love that same cold fire. But I don't know you. I don't know who you are, or what you really are, or what you want. With me, you just trust me. How can I trust the fairies? Tell me the light and soul and trust them? Smile that the flames of the candle are burning. You are what I have in mind for a human, believe me. I could almost feel the wounds deep in my chest as it ripped open and all those awful silent words came pouring out. Illiterate, ignorant, unremarkable, proud, cold. All spoken from left of mouth. All echoing in my head with a sneering voice. I put my lips together. He went and went for the hand slightly, and he stopped the lips for me. Very well, he began. Softly enough, but I just took my hand and left the room. He didn't stop there. But that afternoon, when I went to receive my crumpled wrist from the waste basket, it was gone. And my pile of books had been destroyed. The title was out of order. It was supposed to be a servant, I assured myself, calming the tightness in my chest. This island, and some other bird nest barely cleaning up. I hadn't written anything incriminating. There was no way he knew I'd been trying to warn my family. I doubted he would punish me for it, but the publisher scenario had been bad enough. Still, my hands were unsteady as I took my seat at the little desk and found my face in the book I'd used that morning. I knew it was shameful to mark the books to this, but if Solomon could afford gold plate, he could replace a book or two. I stared at the book without seeing the jumble of letters. Maybe I was a fool for not accepting his help, for not swallowing my pride of having him write the letter in a few moments. Not even a letter of warning, but just to let them know I was hurt. If he had better things to do with his time than come up with ways to embarrass me, then surely he had better things to do than help me write letters to my family. And yet, he got them. A nearby clock chimed the hour. Shortcoming. Another one of my shortcomings. I rubbed my brows with my thumb and forefinger. I was equally foolish for feeling a shred of pity for the lone, grieving fairy. For someone I had so stupidly thought would really care if he met someone who perhaps felt the same, perhaps understood, in my ignorant, insignificant human way, what it was like to bear the weight of caring for others. I should have let his hand bleed that night. Should have known better than to think that maybe there would be someone, human or fairy or whatever, who could understand what my life, what I had become these past few years. A minute passed, then another. Fairies might understand why, but they could certainly withhold information. Cameron, Leeson, and Alice had done their best not to answer my sister's questions. Knowing more about the blood that threatened them, knowing anything about it, where it had come from, what else it could do, and especially what it could do to a human, was worth my time to learn. And if there was a chance that they might possess some knowledge about a forgotten loophole of that damned street, if they knew some way to pay the debt I owed, and to turn me to my family so I might warn them about the blight myself, I had to live this. 20 minutes later, I marked on my little map where it was, in a separate way where the second level, far from mine. And after searching as usual haunts, it was the last place to look. I knocked on the one-piece double door. Come in, human. He could probably detect me by my breathing patterns alone. Or maybe that eye of his could see through the door. as he opened the door. The room was similar to my own space, but was bedecked in trees of orange and red and gold, the first place was green and brown, but smeared in an orange room. But while my room was all softness and grace, his was marked with recognition. In the breakfast table by the window, a worn work table dominates the space, covered in various weapons. It was there, he sat, wearing only a white shirt and trousers, his red hair unbound and gleaming like winter fire. Cameron court king emissary, but a warrior in his own right. Oh, I'll have a few new elements, I said, shutting the door and leaning against it. I had to go put out some hot air from the northern border. Official emissary business, he said, setting down the hunting knife he'd been cleaning, a long strip of flame. I got back in time to hear your little spot with Pam and decided I was safer up here. I'm glad to hear your human heart is warm,
Steve, though.
Yes.
This is kind of like gospel.
I gave him a long look.
This is gospel, Sarah.
Well, he went on shopping.
I think this team is just sitting there.
He managed to get under Cam's fur enough that he stopped me out and nearly bit my head off. So I suppose I can thank you for ruining what should have been a peaceful lunch. Thankfully for me, there's been a disturbance out in the Western Forest. And my poor friend had to go deal with it in that way only two times. I'm surprised you didn't believe in him on the stairs. Thanks for forgotten God for some small monkey. What sort of disturbance? He's been tried, but the movement is too tight to be careless. The usual sort, unwanted nasty creatures raising hell. Good that Cameron was aware and wouldn't be here to talk to him what I planned to do. Another bit of luck.
These kids are just sitting there.
I said it casually as I could, thinking through my words. But it's too bad you're not like the story yet, spouting any information I want if I'm clever enough to share with you. For a moment, he blinked at me. Then his mouth twisted to the side, and that metal eye winked and narrowed on me. I suppose you won't tell me what you want to know. You have your story, and I have mine. I'll take care of it. I couldn't tell whether he would try to convince me otherwise if I told him the truth. But if you were a Syria, I added this deliberate flavor in case you hadn't caught my meaning. How exactly would I talk to you? Lucian set down the knife and pushed at his nose. For a moment, I wondered if he would tell me anything at all. Wondered if he would go right to Cameron and paddle. But then he said, I'd probably have a weakness for groves of young birch trees in the western woods, and suckling slaughtered chickens. I would probably be so greedy that I wouldn't notice the double loop snare rigged around the grove to pin my legs in place. I didn't dare ask why he decided to be accommodating. There was still a good chance he wouldn't mind seeing me dead, but I would miss him. I somehow prefer you if I fell. He smirked, but the amusement was short-lived. If I were insane and stupid enough to go after a serial, I'd also take a bow and quiver and maybe a mug, just like this one. You see, the knife he cleaned and set it down at the edge of the table. And I'll tell you. And I'd be prepared to run like hell when I freed it, to the nearest running water with the hate crossing. But you're not concerned, so you'll be here, safe and sound. I'll be conveniently hunting on the ground. I put my superiors here, and I might be feeling generous enough to listen if someone screams from the western woods. But it's a good thing I have no role in telling you to go out today. Cam would eviscerate anyone who told you how to track a serial. And it's a good thing I plan to hunt anyway. Because if anyone caught me helping you, there would be trouble with a whole other hell awaiting us. I hope your secret is He said it with his usual grin, but there was an edge to it. A woman of his voice. A lover of the rest. And another bit of information. I said, it's a good thing that while you have superior hearing, I possess superior abilities to keep my mouth shut. In order that I took the knife from the table and turned to steer the bow from my room. I think I'm starting to like you.
I think I'm starting to like you. It's so crass, you know what I'm saying?
But then, boy, rules of lumber, bladders thicken, double weak smell, crystalline love. I repeated these instructions as I walked out of the manor, through the cultivated gardens, across the wild, rolling, grassy hills beyond them, over clear streams and into the spring woods beyond. No one had stopped me. No one had even been around to see me leave, throwing silver across my back, each and every night of my time. I lugged along the factual steps with a freshly dead chicken, courtesy of the baffled cooking staff, and has tucked an extra drink into my boots. The land was empty as the manor itself, so I occasionally glimpsed something shining in the corner of my eye. Every time I turned to look, the shimmering sword formed into the sunlight dancing in a nearby stream, or the wind fluttering the leaves of a lone sycamore atop a mirror. As I passed a large pond nestled at the foot of a towering hill, I saw four shining female heads poking up from the bright water, watching me. I heard my step. Only birds and the chittering and rustle of small animals sounded as I entered the still green western forest. I've never ridden through these woods on my hunt for Lucian. There was no path here, nothing tame about it. Elms and beeches intertwined in a thick weave, almost strangling the trickle of sunlight that crept into the dense canopy. The moss-covered earth swallowed any sound I made. Old, this forest was ancient and alive in a way that I couldn't describe but could only feel deep in the marrow of my bones. Perhaps I was the first human in 500 years to walk beneath those heavy, dark branches, to inhale the freshness of spring leaves masking the damp, thick rocks.
Watch my camera. Watch on
there. Running water. I made my way through the woods, breath tight in my throat.
This looks cool.
Night was the dangerous time, I reminded myself. I had only a few hours until sunset. The bog was dead, and whatever horror Cameron was now dealing with boiled in another part of these lands. Strangely, I wondered in what ways Cameron had to answer to his High Lord, or if it was his High Lord who had carved out each one of his eyes. Maybe it was the High Lord's consort. It's he whom we can have mentioned, but I'm still stuck here and now. I pushed away the thought. I kept my stuff right, my eyes and ears open, and my heartbeat steady. Shortcomings and no, I could still hunt. I found a grain of young, skinny birch trees, then stopped another widening circle until I encountered the nearest stream. Not deep, but so wide that I'd have to take a running leap to cross it. Lucian had said to find running water, and this was close enough to make escape possible, if I needed to escape. Hopefully I wouldn't. I searched and then replayed several different routes to the stream. And a few alternate routes, should my access to it somehow be blocked. And when I was sure of every root and rock and hollow in the surrounding area, I returned to the small clearing and circled by those last trees and laid my snare. From my spot up in the nearby trees, a sturdy dense oak vibrant leaves hid me entirely from anyone below. I waited. I comes waiting. Walking in, falling, cracked overhead. Hot enough, even for the canopy, that I had to scrub off my clothes and roll up the trees with my tuna. My stomach grumbled, and I pulled a hunk of cheese out of my rucksack. Eating it would be quieter than the apple I'd also sliced from the kitchen on my way out. When I finished it off, I squeezed water from the canteen I brought, tired from the heat. His camera lens can ever grow tired or scary after the day of eternal spring, or ever venture into the other territory, if only to experience a different season. I wouldn't have minded endless mild spring while looking after my family. Winter brought us dangerously close to death every year. But if I were immortal, I might want a little variation to pass the time. I'd probably want to do more than look about a manor house, too. And I still hadn't worked up the nerve to make the request that had crept into the back of my mind when I saw the mirror. I moved about as much as I dared on the ball, only to keep the blood flowing from the room. I just settled in again when a ripple of silence came toward me. As if the wood rustled and swirled and moths held their breath by something outside. My goal was already set. Quietly, I loosely left an aisle. Closer and closer, the fabric cut. The trees seemed to lean in. Their entwined branches locked in tighter. A living cage keeping even the smallest of birds from flying out of the canopy. Maybe this had been a very bad idea. Maybe we had overestimated my abilities. Or maybe he had been waiting for the chance to lead me to my feet. My muscles strained from holding still across the bar. I kept my balance and taking the chicken look as if it had wandered too far and scratched its own neck as it shot the tree across from a fallen branch. I took and tried to keep my own scent off the bird as much as possible. These days had just seen something, and even though I covered myself, there was a snap, a swoop, and a hollowed-out, wicked scream that made my bones all muffled and breath lock up. Another invasion reached the forum, and my tail groaned as they held, and held, and held. I climbed out of the tree, and went to meet the Tanya. These things, I decided, as I crept up to the fairy in the birch branch, really, truly wanted me dead. I hadn't done what to expect as I entered the ring of white trees. Tall and straight as pillar, but it was not the tall, thin, veiled figure in dark tattered robes. It hunched back facing me, I could count the hard knobs of its spine tugging through the thin fabric. Thinly, shabby gray arms clawed at me now with yellow cracked fingernails. One, some primal instinct of the human taught me whispered, dead. Run and never look back. But I kept my arrow and came up. I said quietly, are you one of the soldiers? The fairy was busy and sniffed once, twice. Then slowly turned to me. The dark bear draped over its bald head, glowing with a phantom breeze. A face that looked like it's been cast with some dry, weather-worn bones, with skin either forgotten or bloody, a lipless mouth, and two long teeth held by blackened bones, with a hole for nostrils and eyes. Eyes that were nothing more than swirling pits of murky light. The white of death. the one that took me. The one that transported me. Speaking above the ragged neck of its dark robe with a body of veins and bones. As dried and fired and horrific as the texture of its face, it let go of the floor, and its two long fingers pushed against each other as it studied me. "You next," it said. And its voice was at once warm and merry, old and young, beautiful and grotesque. My bowels turned watery. "Could you set this clever wicked trap for me? Are you one of the three?" I asked again, my words scarcely more than a rabid breath. "Indeed, I am." Click, 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 went his fingers against each other, one for each word. "And the trap was for you," I managed. "Run, run, run!" It remained sitting, its bare gnarled feet caught in my snow. "I have not seen a human woman for an hour. Come closer, so I might look upon that cat now." I did not touch her. It let out a huffing, awful laugh, and reached my person in my Never again. My mother tells me stories of you. Wow. I can smell the lie on your breath. It slipped again, its fingers clapping together. It cocked its head to the side, and a rather sharp movement, the dark veil snapping with it. What would a human woman want to have a story like? "Speak on me," it said softly. It let out another low laugh. "Of course. A foolish and useless laugh. For if you dare to talk to me, then you must want to laugh very badly." I said nothing, and it smiled with that liquid mouth. It showed these horrible lies. "I'll clean the pot in this moment."
"Fuck!"
"And then clean it. I saw it hard. Is there clearly no way for me to go home? Nothing left you to secure and your family with you. You must remain." Whatever lies yet of hope I've been clinging to, whatever foolish optimism shriveled and died, it changed nothing. Before my fight with Cameron that morning, I hadn't even entertained the idea anyway. Perhaps I'd only come here out of sight. So, fine. If I was here facing sure death, then I might as well learn something. What do you know about Cameron? Not specific demons? Do not specific. Oh, no, could many things about the High Lord of the same court. He was so forgiving to me. Cameron is a high lord. Not just one petty fairy lord of a manor, but a high lord of one of the seven territories. A high lord of Scythian. Did you also not know that this is the Supreme Court to the season? Yes. Yes, I know about that. The fairy lord falls on the ground. Spring, summer, autumn, winter, dawn, day, and night. It means, as if I hadn't even answered. The seven courts of Scythia, each ruled by a high lord, all of them definite in their own way. They're not merely powerful, they are power. That was why Cameron had been able to take the bog and live. High lord. I have to wait my feet. Everyone at the same court is just wearing a mask, and yet, you aren't, I think, consciously. Are you not a member of the court? I am a member of my court. I am older than the High Lord, older than Pythian, older than the bones of the fire. These things have definitely overestimated my abilities. And what can be done about this blast that I spread into him, feeling and altering the man and where can come from?
I will not be able to do that.
Covered in dark scales and nothing more. They were a horrendous combination of serpentine features and male humanoid bodies, whose powerful arms ended in polished glass, flesh-drained talons. Here were the creatures
epic,
of the blood-filled bludgeons, the ones that slipped through the wall to torment and slaughter mortals. The ones I would have been glad to kill that day in the snowy woods. Their huge, almond-shaped eyes greedily took in the Thorio and me. The four of them paused across the clearing, the Thorio between us, and I trained my arrow toward the one in the center. The creature smiled, a row of razor-sharp teeth greeting me as a silvery forked tongue darted out. The Dark Mother has sent us a gift today, brothers, he said, gazing at the Thorio, who was clawing at the snare now. The mother's amber eyes shifted toward me again. And a meal. Not much sleep, another one said, flexing its claws. I began backing away, toward the stream, toward the manor below, keeping my arrow pointed at them. One scream from me would notify Lucia, but my breath was thin. And he might not come at all if he'd sent me here. I kept every sense fixed on my retreating step. Human, the Thorio gasped. I had 10 arrows. 9 once I fired the one knocked in my bow. None of them asked, but maybe they'd keep the naga down long enough for me to flee. I backed away another step. The four naga crept closer, as if savoring the slowness of the hunt, as if they already knew how I tasted. I had 3 heartbeats to make up my mind. 3 heartbeats to execute my plan. I drew my bowstring back farther, my arm trembling. And then I screamed, sharp and loud, and with every bit of air in my too tight lungs. With the naga now focused entirely on me, I fired at the tether holding the Thorio in place. The snare shattered. Like a shadow on the wind, the Thorio was off. A blast of dark that sent the naga staggering back. The one closest to me surged toward the Thorio, the strong column of its scaly neck pushing out. No chance of my movements being considered an unprovoked attack anymore. Not now that they'd seen my aim. They still wanted to kill me. So I let my arrow fly. The tip glittered like a shooting star through the gloom of the forest. And all of a blink before it struck home and blood sprayed. The naga toppled back, just as the remaining 3 whirled to me. I didn't know if it was a killing shot. I was already gone. I chased the machine, using the path I calculated earlier, not daring to look back. My only hope of getting away alive lay in outrunning them long enough to reach Lucian. And then, only if he was there as he promised to be. I didn't let myself think of all the hills I would have to climb once I cleared the forest itself, or what
nice
I would
play,
do if
nice
Lucian had changed his mind. The crashing through the brush became louder, closer, and I veered to the right, leaping over the stream. Running water might have scratched the Thorio, but a hiss on the thud close behind me told me it was nothing to hold the naga after. I careened through a thicket. A thorn zipped at my cheek. I barely felt their clinging fingers or the warm blood sliding down my face. I didn't even have time to wink. Not as 2 dark figures flanked me, closing in to cut me off. My knees groaned as I pushed myself harder, focusing on the growing brightness of the wood's end. But the naga to my right rushed at me so fast that I could only leap aside to avoid the flashing talons. I stumbled but stayed upright, just as the naga on my left. I hurled myself into a shot, swinging my bow up in a wide arc. I nearly lost my grip as it connected with that serpentine face, and bone crunched with a horrific beat.
Holding the knife. Cameron got to his feet,
wrenching his claws out of the creature's abdomen. Blood and gore drip from them, staining the deep
sea. Someone got all mad because I didn't get a single, like, score in that game.
And I was just like, why
are you so toxic, bro? You need a hug?
Feral rage.
You need some Jesus?
And I flinch as he knelt beside
me. I can help you with that.
He reached for me again, but I jerked back, away from the bloody claws that were still out. I raised myself into a sitting position before the chasing resumed. I knew I couldn't get to my feet. Tayra, he said. The wrath faded from his eyes, and the claws slipped back under his skin, but the roar still sounded in my ears. There had been nothing in that sound but primal fury. How? It was all I could manage to say, but he understood me. I was tracking a pack of them. These four escaped and must have followed your scent through the woods. I heard you scream. So he didn't know about the cereal, and he'd come to help me. He reached a hand toward me, and I shuddered as he ran cool, wet fingers down my stinging, aching cheek. Blood. That was blood on them. And from the stickiness
okay?
on my face,
yeah, okay.
I knew there was already enough blood splattered on me that it wouldn't make a difference.
Huh? I'm asking what you want to do.
The pain in my face and my arms faded and vanished. His eyes darkened a bit at the bruise I knew was already blossoming on my cheekbone.
Try this one more time, then I'm going to go.
But the throbbing quickly left. The metallic scent of magic came around me and floated away on a light breeze. I found one dead half a mile away, he went on, his hand leaving my face as he unbuckled his baldric. Then sucked off his tunic and handed it to me. The front of my own had been ripped and torn by the talons of a naga. I saw one of my arrows in its throat, so I followed their tracks here. I pulled on Tamlin's tunic over my own, ignoring how easily I could see the cut of his muscles beneath his white shirt, and the way the blood soaking it made them stand out even more. A purebred predator. Homes to kill without a second thought, without remorse. I shivered again and savored the warmth that leaked from the cloth. High Lord. I should have known. Should have guessed. Maybe I hadn't wanted to. Maybe I'd been afraid.
Here, he said,
rising to his feet and offering me a blood-stained hand. I didn't dare look at the slaughtered naga as I gripped his extended hand and he pulled me to my feet. My knees buckled, but I stayed upright. I stared at our linked hands, both coated in blood and one corner. No.
Oh, shit.
He hadn't been the only one to spill blood just now. And it wasn't just my blood that still coated my tongue. Perhaps that made me as much of a beast as him. He saved me. Killed for me. I sat onto the grass, wishing I hadn't lost my canteen.
Do I want to know what you were doing out here? He asked.
No, definitely not. Not after he'd warned me plenty of times already. I thought I wasn't confined to the house of Martin. I didn't realize they'd come so far. He dropped my hand.
On the days that I'm called away to deal with trouble, stay close to the house.
I nodded a bit numbly. Thank you, I mumbled, fighting past the chicken racking my body, my mind. The naga's blood on me became nearly unbearable. I sat again. Not just for this. For saving my life, I mean. I wanted to tell him how much that meant. That the High Lord of the Spring Court thought I was worth saving. I couldn't find a word. His bang vanished.
It was the least I could do. They shouldn't have gotten this far onto my land. He shook his head, more at himself, his shoulders slumping. Let's go home, he said, sparing me the effort of explaining why I'd been out there in the first place. I couldn't bring myself to tell him that the manor wasn't my home, that I might not even have a home at all anymore. We walked back in silence, both of us blood-drenched and pale. I could still sense carnage we left behind, the blood-soaked ground and the trees, the pieces of the mountain. Well, I'd learned something from this earlier, at least. Even if it wasn't entirely what I wanted to hear, or know. Staying with the High Lord. Fine. Easy enough. But as for the history lesson that has been in the middle of giving me, about wicked kings and their commanders, and however they tied into the High Lord at my side and the Blight, I still didn't have enough specifics to be able to thoroughly warn my family. But the story always told me about the gold.
What?
Okay. I had a feeling I would surely be a fool to ignore his advice. My family would have to make do with the bare bones of my knowledge, then. Hopefully, it would be enough. I didn't ask him anything more about the Naga, about how many he killed before those four slipped away. Didn't ask him anything at all. Because I didn't detect a trace of triumph in him, but rather a deep, unending sort of pain and defeat. Chapter 16. After soaking in the bath for nearly an hour, I found myself sitting in a low back chair with my wings blowing
fire. How'd you even see me, dude?
Savoring the feel of all that fucking out my damn hair. Their dinner was to be served soon. Alex had a cup of molten chocolate brought up and refused to do anything until I'd had a few sips. It was the best thing I'd ever tasted. I drank from the thick blood as she brushed my hair, nearly crying at the feel of the thin fingers along my scalp. But when the other maids had gone downstairs to help with the evening meal, I lowered my mug and my mouth. If your families keep crossing the court borders of the compound,
they will be no more. Damn, what the fuck, over?
Maybe we
should
just take a stand.
Like, I know I get on some games, I'm fucking awesome, and like this fucking first person, I suck balls, dude. This is awful.
Aggressive.
I can't get shit.
Don't ask that question, you'll call on bad luck.
I'm sitting
in my seat, glaring up into a masked face. Why aren't the other High Lords keeping their subjects in line? Why are these awful creatures allowed to roam wherever they want? Someone began telling me a story about a king in Highburn. Alice grabbed my shoulder and pivoted me around. It's none of your concern. Oh, I think it is. I turned around again, sitting in the back of the wooden chair.
Damn, dude.
If this spills into the human world,
shit.
If there's war or this blood poisons our land, I pushed back against the crushing panic. I had to warn my family, had to write to them, soon. The less you know, the better. Let Lord Tamlin deal with it. He's the only one who can. The story all had said as much. You think no one would tell me what you asked the kitchen to give you today, or realize what you went to trap? Foolish, stupid girl. Had the cereal not been in the benevolent mood, you would have deserved the death it gave you. I don't know what worse. This, or your idiocy with the puka. Would you have done anything else? If you had a family, I do have a family. I looked her up and down. There was no ring on her finger. Alice noticed my stare and said, "My sister and her mate were murdered nigh on 50 years ago, leaving two younglings behind. Everything I do, everything I work for is for those boys. So you don't get the right to give me that look and ask me if I would do anything different, girl."
Where are they? Do they live here? Perhaps that was why they were so
fucking adorable.
Maybe those two small shining figures in the garden. Maybe that had been them. No, they don't live here, she said, too sharply. They are somewhere else, far away. I considered what.
I'm a TurboTax Live expert, ready to assess even the. The next time that fool group changes to advice on how to stop the story or new company, get kicked my sagging ass. All you needed to do was offer it a new robe and it would have groveled at your feet. By the time I entered the dining room, I stopped kicking, and some semblance of warmth had returned to my veins. Our Lord of Christian or no, I wouldn't power. Not after what I've been through today. Houston and Tamlin were already waiting for me at the table. Good evening, I said, moving to my usual seat. Houston cocked his head in a silent inquiry, and I gave him a subtle nod as I sat. His secret was still safe, so he deserved to be walloped for sending me so unprepared to the cereal. Houston slouched a bit in his chair. I heard you two had a rather exciting afternoon. I wish I could have been there to help. A hidden, perhaps half-hearted apology, and I gave him another little nod. He said with forced brightness, well, you still look lovely, regardless of your health that afternoon. I snorted. I've never looked lovely a day in my life. I thought fairies couldn't lie. Tamlin choked on his wine, but Houston grinned. That sky stark and brutal. Who told you that? Everyone knows it, I said, piling food on my plate, even as I began wondering about everything they'd said to me so far. Every statement I'd accepted as pure truth. Houston leaned back in his chair, smiling with feeling and delight. Of course we can lie. We find lies and lies. Every lie when we told those ancient mortals that we couldn't speak an untruth, how else would we get them to trust us and do our bidding? My mouth became a thin, tight line. He was telling the truth, because if he was lying, the logic of it made my head spin. I am, I managed to say. Doesn't do us a lick of harm, only us, as you well know. My face warmed. I've taken everything they said as truth. Perhaps the cereal had been lying today too, with that long-winded explanation about the politics of the fairy realm, about staying with the High Lord and everything being fixed in the end. I looked to Tamlin. High Lord, that wasn't a lie. I could feel its truth in my bones. Even though he didn't act like the High Lords of Legend, who had sacrificed virgins and slaughtered humans at will. No, Tamlin was exactly as those fanatic, calf-eyed children of the Blessed had depicted the bounties and comforts of Christian. Even though Lucian revealed some of our closely guarded secrets, Tamlin said, throwing the last word at his companion with a growl.
We've never used your misinformation against you. We did not mind. We never willingly lied to you. I managed the nod and took a long sip of water. I ate in silence.
Oh shit, dude. Andrew Cuomo's aide admits his New York hid COVID-19 nursing home deaths to avoid federal investigation.
Yeah.
This is on Bipart News right now. You guys can't probably see it. Yeah, I can pull it up on my phone. Yeah, that's fucking cool.
Better? So he had his chin propped on a fist, concern, and perhaps surprised at that concern, so in his eyes. I swallowed hard.
Total carnage!
I consider myself fortunate.
What were you doing out in the Western woods?
Truth or lie or truth? Both. I heard a legend once about a creature who answers your questions if you can catch it. Cameron blinked as his claws shot out, slashing his face. But the wounds closed as soon as they opened, leaving only a smear of blood running down his golden skin, which he wiped away with the back of his sleeve.
You went to catch the serial.
I caught the serial, I corrected.
And did it tell you what you wanted?
I wasn't sure if he was breathing.
Well then.
What's up?
We were interrupted by the novel before it could tell me anything more.
Yeah,
about.
Fucking ads.
Game
doesn't work right now, so I'm gonna try some black smoke.
I've stopped shouting, but I think today was punishment enough.
We go on a fucking steam binge and just look at all the free games in it.
Yeah,
Apex. Yeah, I don't fucking PC, maybe I do better.
Despite myself, despite the afternoon, my lips twitched upward. Is it supposed to be hard? He chuckled, then fished something out of his pocket.
Well, if I'm lucky, I won't have to trap the serial to learn what this is about.
He lifted my crumpled list of words. My heart dropped
yes,
to my
please.
Stomach.
Actually, no. I don't do Star Wars.
I couldn't think of a suitable lie.
Fuck Star Wars.
Everything was absurd.
He read the list. I wanted to curl up and die.
Words I couldn't recognize from the book. Words that now seemed so simple, so absurdly easy if he was saying them aloud.
Is this a poem about murdering me and then burning my body?
My throat closed up and I had to clench my hands into fists to keep from hiding my face behind them. Good night, I said. Barely more than a whisper, and stood on shaking knees. I was nearly to the door when he spoke again.
You love them very much, don't you?
I half turned to him. His green eyes met mine as he rose from his chair to walk to me. He stopped a respectable distance away. The list of malformed words was still clutched in his hand.
I wonder if your family realizes it,
he murmured.
That everything you've done wasn't about that promise to your mother, or for your sake, but for theirs.
I said nothing, not trusting my voice to keep my shame hidden.
I know that when I said it earlier, it didn't come out well. But I could help you write.
Leave me alone, I said. I was almost to the door when I ran into someone, into him. I stumbled back a step. I'd forgotten how fast he was.
I'm not insulting you.
His quiet voice made it all the worse. I don't need your help. Clearly not.
He was sad as hell for the half strung bed. He was so beautiful.
A human who can take all day in a wolf's skin. Married the serial and killed two mother on her own.
What?
She stepped on a log and shook his head. The firelight danced along his mouth.
The fool. Who
cool for not doing it. We wish. But his eyes held no mischief. Yeah, he said, extending the list of words. I shoved it into my pocket. I turned and he gently grabbed my arm. He lifted his other hand as if to brush my cheek. I braced myself for the touch, and he lowered it before making contact. I took off his arm, unable to stop his angry words. Oh Lord, he said. I don't want this kid. His green eyes were so bright I couldn't look away.
Fuck this shit, I'm out. No thanks. Don't mind me. I'ma just grab my stuff and leave. Excuse me, please. Fuck this shit, I'm out. No. Fuck this shit, I'm out. Alright then. I don't know what the fuck just happened, but I don't really care. I'ma get the fuck up out of here. Fuck this shit, I'm out.
Thank you.
Okay.
my lord Peregrine and that you were no more than a sack of grain. And my lord Peregrine of the lesser fairies with his bleached skin, dangling limbs, bright ears, and long on a tail. But even when it crossed the trail, a bead of blood crossing down the fairy's back.
Thank you.
Really like to be where I was?
His dark eyes shifted to mine, beseeching, pleading.